This is Eye on Africa, France 24's program focused on the continent. I'm Charlie Jameson for Georgia Calvin Smith today, and here's what's ahead. Tunisia's president says the democratically elected parliament will remain suspended for at least another year. Saied also announced a referendum and elections. Our correspondent in Tunis joins in just a minute. The EU slaps sanctions on a Russian mercenary group it says commits atrocities in several African nations. We explain what Wagner operatives are doing on the continent. And the UN calls a special session to discuss human rights in Ethiopia. This is Tigrayan forces claim to have taken back territory that the government recaptured from them just days ago. We begin in Tunisia, where President Kais Saied has extended the suspension of parliament until at least December of next year. That's when elections will be held. He also called a referendum on constitutional reforms to be held in July. Saied suspended parliament almost 5 months ago, consolidating power for himself. For more on this story, let's cross to our correspondent in Tunis, Fadil Ali Reza. Fadil, tell us more about this announcement. Was it expected or a surprise?
There were expectations that the president would be making some big announcements. And it was actually expected for December 17th, which is an important date, the anniversary when the Tunisian Revolution began. However, he did it early. It's unclear why he decided to make these a few days early. But included in the decisions was, this decision to call for popular consultations on political reforms, which he'll be doing through online tools. With a referendum that's set to be held next July 25th, so exactly 1 year from the day that he dismissed parliament. It's unclear exactly how this will work. Internet penetration is actually quite low for the older generation and in rural areas. And it's clear that the president has always wanted to change the political system, but it's unclear how such a popular discussion will work and if it will support him or contradict his vision. At the same time, as you said, there'll be a continuation of the suspension of the parliament, but there will be new elections under a new electoral law. It's not clear what the new electoral law is, whether this will look like the same parliament as before or if it will be an entirely different parliamentary system. The president has said he's supported in the past a system whereby local councils would elect representatives to go to a parliament. He's also been very much against political parties in general. So the parliament that he's announced that there'll be elections for next year maybe look very different than the one today. But there has been growing pressure on the president to make some announcement like this with a little bit of a more clarity on where he's going. It's been 5 months since he decided to dismiss parliament and the last government. It's been it took him 3 months to name a new government, and now 5 months before we really see a bit more clarity in where he's going from now. And even parties that had initially supported his initial decisions have been calling for him to give more details, more clarity, have more dialogue with different partners and include them in the process.
France 24's Fadil Ali Reza in Tunis, thank you so much for that update. The European Union has imposed sanctions on a group of private Russian military contractors it accuses of fueling violence and committing human rights abuses in the Middle East, Ukraine, and Africa. The Wagner Group is currently present in Libya, the Central African Republic, and the Sahel region. Its operatives have been accused of torture and executions, as well as looting and fueling violence. Political scientist Niagale Bagayoko, who is chair of the African Security Sector Network, told France 24 about the Wagner Group's presence on the continent.
In Mali, officially, Wagner Group is not deployed. There have been lots of rumors in the past 2 months suggesting that the government of Mali could negotiate an agreement with this Wagner Group. But for the time being, they have not arrived, and there is absolutely no proof that such an agreement will be concluded. What is important to say is that Wagner Group, yes, is present in the Central African Republic, but also has been deployed in Libya as well as in Mozambique and in Sudan on the African continent. And in all the cases, it has never been really able to change the strategic security situation, but rather it has illustrated itself by committing abuses, looting. In fact, the Wagner Group intervention in Mozambique and in Libya has really been a kind of a disaster. In the Central African Republic, the situation is rather different because the group is mostly committed in securing the government itself and the authorities, and has also been able to be present on the ground all over the territory of CAR. But it's important to recognize the fact that the security situation itself, even in the CAR, has definitely not changed.
The United Nations Human Rights Council will hold a special session on Friday to discuss the conflict in Ethiopia. It will consider whether to appoint international investigators to look into widespread violations. More than a year of fighting between the Tigray People's Liberation Front and government forces has claimed thousands of lives. And in the latest twist, rebels have retaken the town of Lalibela 11 days after Ethiopian forces said they had gained control. Ellen Gainsford brings us the story.
Only 11 days after it was retaken by the government, the historic Ethiopian city of Lalibela is once again in rebel hands. According to residents, fighters from the Tigray People's Liberation Front entered the city center on Sunday after government forces left on Saturday night and were able to retake the area with no exchange of fire. A UNESCO World Heritage Site, Lalibela is a place of pilgrimage for Ethiopian Christians, thanks to its 11 medieval monolithic cave churches carved out of red rock. Fighting broke out in Ethiopia more than a year ago over a power struggle for the Tigray region. Since June, the rebels have retaken several major towns and expanded the conflict from Tigray into the neighboring Afar and Amhara regions. When the capital, Addis Ababa, appeared at risk in November, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed himself went to lead his troops. According to his office, he's once again on the front line, and government forces have recently recaptured strategic locations, including the towns of Arjo, Fokiza, and Borin. The conflict has displaced more than 2 million people and pushed nearly 9 million to the brink of starvation. There have been reports of massacres and rapes by both sides. Human Rights Watch is calling for a United Nations probe into the alleged war crimes.
Ghana's main international airport imposing hefty fines on airlines who bring passengers not vaccinated against COVID-19. Each person who arrives unvaccinated or tests positive will cost airlines $3,500. The rule follows a new health ministry requirement that all people entering Ghana be vaccinated. France 24's Hanan Ferjani has more on the decision.
It's indeed a drastic preventive approach that the Ghanaian authorities have chosen to adopt. It will no longer be possible to enter the country with a negative PCR test or to self-isolate for 15 days. Ghanaian citizens and residents abroad are exempt from the new rules for up to 2 weeks, but will be required to get jabbed upon landing at the airport. And the same goes for Ghanaians leaving the country by plane. They will be required to be fully vaccinated. Now, those new traveling rules come just days before the end of the year celebration, a crucial period for the tourism sector, which has already been battered since the start of the pandemic. But the authorities say they fear an upsurge in infections during the holiday season. The country is also set to charge airlines a $3,500 fee per unvaccinated passenger, effective from Tuesday, a measure that may help authorities compensate for some of the expected loss in tourism revenue. Ghana announced in late November that it had detected its first cases of the Omicron variant in travelers coming from Nigeria and South Africa. According to official figures, the country has recorded 130,000 cases of COVID-19 since the beginning of the crisis in 2020. 627 new cases were reported in the past week.
Finally on the program, the African philosophical concept of Ubuntu is a complex one to translate, but it relates to a sense of collective humanity and harmony. its most famous adherent is probably Nelson Mandela. One way to understand it is visually, through a new exhibit at the Palais de Tokyo here in Paris. 20 artists were invited to reflect on the concept, and our team takes you to see it.
How can we rekindle our sense of common humanity? This unfortunate timeless quandary is the foundation of Ubuntu, and the question that was posed to the more than 20 non-Western artists presented by the Palais de Tokyo.
Actually, artists aren't here to bring us answers. They're here to help us think about the world differently, to open up our imaginations to other ways of thinking, like Ubuntu, which could maybe help us imagine a different future.
Nolan Oswald Dennis is one of those people who likes pushing boundaries, tracing them with his own footsteps, and in the process, appropriate and reinvent a space that's been rocked by colonization.
It's a map of places that exist but don't exist at the same time. Dreams, fantasies, political mythologies. It's a map of Africa that doesn't exist yet. And it's painted on the floor. It invites you to walk, to be a part of it. And the more people walk across it, the more it changes.
With Ubuntu, we can also reimagine the role of women in society. Through the works of Colombian artist Daniel Otero Torres, depictions of Amazon warriors of all stripes who were ignored in a history written and told by men. A choice also made by Turia Magadlela when she asks of visitors to walk into this tent made of hundreds of women's tights, each and every piece telling an original story, but weaved together in a collective female history of humanity.
Every single woman in our continent should be represented somehow. If you look at the finer details of the work, sometimes you see people's names, sometimes you see the company's names that made the paintings. So I don't take out any of that detail.
Every piece, every artist brings their own vision of Ubuntu, leading to an experience with an abundance of perspectives as diverse as humanity itself.
You stay with us here on France 24. More news up next.